Hello everyone, my name is Veronica Chupligina and I'm an assistant professor at Eindhoven University of Technology, although I'm soon leaving my tenure track position, and which is why I also wanted to tell you today about how I failed to learn from successful academics. So if you already know me, it might be from one of two things. The first is my research on not-to-supervised learning, for example, transfer learning. And the second is my Twitter and my blog, where I discuss failure in particular in academia. Or okay, maybe a third one is my obsession with cats. But in this talk, I try to unite the first two things, so my research topics and failure, to explain a little bit about my career and how I failed to learn from successful academics. So many stories of why people went into academia start out with big dreams of solving a particular research problem. Mine was a little bit less exciting. I liked doing research, and there was a group that I liked, but also having experienced the effect of job insecurity when I was a child, doing research as a job for 4 years sounded great. So I certainly had no long-term plans for an academic career at that point in time. But of course, even without these kind of ambitions, I wanted to do a good job at what I signed up for. So I tried to do things that moved me as a data point towards success. So I wrote papers, as I understood that was a good thing to do. And then I also went to several small conferences where I had engaging discussions with other researchers. And of course, I also did some sightseeing. So this was great for my development as a researcher. But it turned out when applying for grants later, for example, that this was not such a success. Because if your grant reviewer hasn't heard of a conference, then it doesn't really count. Another thing I did is that I volunteered for various activities next to research, for example, organizing workshops, which people told me were good for my CV, but most of all, which I enjoyed and which I felt were helping other people. But also here, it turned out that there is a certain non-linearity. Because if you do more than a minimum threshold, well, you'll get a thank you, but probably not a grant or a permanent position. But after 4 years, I did get a PhD. And during that time, I also discovered that I enjoyed doing research more and more, and I enjoyed the academic community. So I started thinking about staying in academia. And this was a time to doubt myself a lot, because I knew that it's really tough to find a position afterwards. And also it didn't help that many people were telling me that I had to go abroad to have any shot at an academic career. But in the end, by talking to more people, I decided to give it a try without leaving the country, which was career suicide. But I decided to go for one postdoc and see, and if I was able to get a position after, and if not, I would leave academia. So the next 2 years were kind of hard, because I again tried to do things that would move me towards success, and this meant going after three objectives at the same time. So publishing on the project that I was hired for, but also developing my own research, but also I already had to soon start applying for my next position or grant. So I clearly overfitted somewhere, because I had to, in the end, take time off, take medical leave because of depression and anxiety. But it was also during this point that I started blogging and tweeting more. So it started with me publishing my CV of failures on my website, which I thought would be documenting a story of me leaving academia after that position. However, the response to this was overwhelmingly positive, and so I decided to do more with this, and that's how I started the How I Fail series on my blog, where I now interviewed around 30 academics about their failures. So during all of this, I found a very supportive Twitter community, and also just many others who were going through similar struggles. So that was extremely helpful. The year after, I did, much to my surprise, find myself in a tenure track position after all. So this is definitely a success, but at the same time, there was also already the next challenge of getting tenure on the horizon. But I thought, you know, now I had more mentors, I had a support group, I also had more awareness of academia, and finally also a little bit of confidence that I really belong. So although without startup, it was difficult to start producing research, I did write a few papers that people cited. I even got a grant. I had a great time teaching several subjects and supervising student projects. And I also got several kind thank you emails about all of the above. So I thought things were going quite well. But still, I was missing some other features that the true positives or the tenured professors had, like more papers and more grants. Fortunately, the medication I had been taking for my depression was helpful with this, because I was feeling better and I was getting more ideas, and I needed also less sleep, so I could put a few extra hours into the grant writing. And then after a couple of weeks of particular intensive writing, my brain experienced catastrophic failure, in which I had a psychotic episode where I had put myself in a life-threatening situation and had to be institutionalized for a couple of days. So now I also had to take a longer leave of absence of several months and yet other medication to keep me functioning. So this was something that definitely wasn't advertised on the successful CVs that I've seen. So all in all, I'm failing to learn from example somehow. While trying to move myself into the direction of the decision boundary, in the end I discover often that the rules are different after all. So there's some kind of distribution shift going on. And I'm slowly realizing that it's not me, but it's just an ill-defined learning problem. What do I mean by this? Well, first, we are led to believe that success is a function of your CV. But there are, of course, other factors involved. So firstly, the number of positions and funding might be different than a few years ago when your role models got promoted and got their funding. So it's at least a function of your CV, but also the world at the moment. Another hugely important factor is your gender, the country where you were born, any disability you might have, and actually anything that influences the amount of privilege you get to start with will also play a role. So you and your experiences are important features as well. But interestingly, these additional features might not be taken into account when creating the rules that lead to this is what a successful CV looks like. So as a result, even if you try to do everything right, you might get an unexpected output in the end. I also think there are many unexplored dimensions in this space. So things you can do which are related kind of to all three factors of the CV world and you. And there are dimensions that didn't really exist, for example, 10 years ago. So for me, this has definitely been the outreach that I've been doing on my blog and Twitter. So next to finding an incredibly helpful and supportive place, I actually think that the time I put into this is steadily translating into real world impact, and maybe even academic impact. So for example, through being on Twitter, it's easy to connect with any researchers in the world as long as they're on Twitter as well. So this way I've been able to have many conversations with researchers who I wouldn't really dare to approach at a conference, for example. But just a warning though, that if you publish an interview with Ian Goodfellow on your website, you might need to invest in a little bit more bandwidth. So when the interview went live, my website host thought that all the traffic I was getting was a DDoS attack. So they shut my website down completely. The other spike is, by the way, from a half year ago when I announced that I was planning to leave my position. Coming back to new dimensions, I also started collaborations online. So for example, with several academics in the Netherlands who are in different fields and who not all of them I've met in person before this paper. We wrote a paper about how to start using Twitter as a scientist. So this was published by PLOS Computational Biology. And although it's recent, it's quite a popular paper. So here I have the altmetric score, which measures not only citations, but also how many people mention the paper online and download it and save it to their library and so forth. And also quite global reach. So in comparison, my other most popular paper, which is the survey on not-to-supervised learning, has a much more modest impact. I'm not really sure how to quantify all of this, but I estimate that so far over 100,000 people have read at least one of my blog posts, and that I have between 100 and 1,000 emails and messages from people who have told me that following me online and reading what I write has helped them in some way, giving them ideas, support, or just the feeling that they're not the only ones with a particular problem. So although I have papers which are being read and cited, I think I can't hope to achieve the same impact by inventing yet another deep learning classifier. But that's, it seems, what a management team would rather have me do. Coming back to the not-to-supervised problem, the second issue, I think, is that we have a biased problem with only positive and unlabeled examples in our training set. So we know that specific careers that's considered successful, like professor, or maybe you started your own startup company after a PhD. But we don't really have true negative examples because there's no directory of people who didn't get the position or a grant. And even if there was, probably we wouldn't call them failures. So as an extreme example, I know somebody who quit his master's program in computer science halfway, which many people told him was an irresponsible decision. But then he moved to a beach house in Thailand somewhere where he does programming jobs 1 or 2 days a week and then spends the rest of his time with his family reading or giving yoga workshops. And I'm sure at least some of us would appreciate a lifestyle like this. But the story is just often not in our training data when we're making career decisions for ourselves. Finally, I believe that career success is some kind of proxy loss function for being happy that what you have achieved in your work so far. Sure, you might need a little bit of a career to get to a point where you start making impact on people. But I think it's nothing like the number of achievements that we are expected to have nowadays. You know, especially if you don't have the features to get a head start that's needed. So to conclude, I would like to say that I'm in the end quite happy with all of my choices, and that it feels good to no longer be chasing the decision boundary. How that looks like for me is that I'm now searching on a position on the intersection of research, training researchers, and open science. But I'm also developing my business where I give workshops on failure, but also, for example, social media. So please contact me if your group might be interested. And finally, I would like to say that I think if this is what it looks like, I'm proud to call myself a failed academic. That's all I wanted to share with you today. Thank you for your attention.